God bless you, loved ones. Welcome to the Word with Chester. Today we'll begin study in the 18th chapter of the book of Revelation. God bless each of you. I thank God for all of you that's been with us through the study of Revelation. I'm sure that you've been blessed through it, and many of you have been with us since we started the New Testament studies. We started in April of 2011. With the Gospel of St. Matthew, and have now progressed to this point in the 18th chapter of the book of Revelation. We're coming very close to the conclusion of the New Testament, and I trust that you have gotten something out of His Word. I know I have been energized through His Word, and I feel that I've been blessed through studying and sharing with you. We'll start our study momentarily in the first verse of chapter 18, but let me make the appeal that I made yesterday. I'm asking for credible ministries, credible ministers, and churches, or whatever your type of ministry is, as long as you have a foundation and a good solid Bible base. We would like to send people to you, people that call us and receive salvation, or they need further enlightenment in the Word of God. I would like to send them to you and your church. I know my job is to teach and preach the Word of God verse by verse and chapter by chapter, and in doing so, many come to Jesus. But I don't want to leave people out there alone and by themselves. I want to direct them somewhere where they can get the Word of God and get a strong foundation in the things of God. And I need good, strong ministries that teach a sound doctrine. I would like for you to send me your information. Give me a call. We have a toll-free number. Or I will, at the conclusion of this study today, we will give you our contact information. Write us a note. Write us a letter. Tell us about yourself and where your church is. I would like to send people to you when they call us or talk to us from any part in the United States or the world, as far as that matter goes. I would like to send them to you so they can get nurtured in the ways of Christ. Well, shall we begin our study today in the 18th chapter of the book of Revelation, beginning at verse 1. The Bible reads, "And after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was made bright with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon, the great is fallen, and has become the habitations of demons, and the hold of every foul spirit, and cage of every unclean and hateful bird." I'm going to read another verse, and I will talk more. "And all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornications with her, and the merchants of the earth are grown rich through the abundance of her delicacies." Well, let's just talk about that, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but let me enlighten a few things. When we're talking about this city, Great Babylon, the Bible styles this place as the Great Whore. Let me give you some information on that. You know, I don't knock nationalities of people to try to lambast people in the heritage and things of that nature. But let me give you just a little history on Babylon. We know we read about it in the Old Testament scripture. We read about Nebuchadnezzar being the king of Babylon all through the book of Daniel. It talks all the way in Bible days. We've talked about this region in Babylon. And the Bible, we read our last chapter in chapter 7. 17, when it was talking about this great whore. You got to get an understanding of what we're talking about, and let me give you a geological location of where this Babylon is and was. You have to understand this is a land between two rivers, the great Euphrates River and also the Tigris River. They run on both sides of this city and this region, and is also very close to the mouth of the Persian Gulf. Well, you got to get this picture. This was a center of commerce. There were people and kings and all type of merchants came through this area, not just one nationality of people, but they came through this area because it had heavy travel. world from the rivers and the Persian Gulf. They can get their commerce to a place. The commerce can come in from the Persian Gulf, actually anywhere, because it can leak into the other oceans and seas, and they can ship cargo in to this region, and also it can be distributed there in that city and go all up and down the two rivers, the Euphrates River and the Tigris River, to where it could take commerce and also commerce could come in to be sold. So this was a heavy commercial area. Now, and you got to understand, it brought in such an abundance of money. Many people went there and got very, very wealthy. And whether you want to know it or not, we want to style the city as a great whore. So what we got to talk about, anywhere there's money is, it's also going to bring that type of business in as well. If business is going well in the commerce industry, where they're selling goods and there's a lot of money in an area, in a region, there's also going to be a lot of the nightlife, if you please, that will go on there, because commerce goes farther than our local grocery store, whether you know it or not. You can call it commerce. Well, there are people out to make money, and not only off of legitimate means, but also off of illegitimate means. A lot of things went around in this region. Yes, it brought in such commerce and brought in so many dollars coming from everywhere and every kingdom, especially in that area and in that region. So much money was to be made. It also brought in all types of other illegitimate business as well. Drug trafficking, and not only drug trafficking, trafficking of women and things of that nature, harlotry, just think about it. If you've ever driven anywhere in a large city, where are those type of people? Where is the prostitute going to be? She's going to be out where heavy traffic is, where she can get some business. She's not going to be off on no little side street where ain't no traffic is. She want to be out there where she can be seen and show her stuff, and then somebody will solicit her of what she has to offer. Well, you got to understand, this was the region, and the Bible called it a great whore because so many different things went on in that area. Not only the strength of the commerce of the legitimate goods, fine linens and jewelries and all of these type of things traveled through Babylon, and not only the legitimate linens and all of the fabrics, fine fabrics, and the precious stones and all of those things traveled through this area. There was also a lot of money to be made through illegal means. It brought in also a nightlife, if you please. Merchants would come in and travel and to unwind themselves. You know, some of it happens today. You go to a convention to go to your business convention. Don't you know, after the main session is over, there's a whole lot of other things go on, business people and things of that nature, meet up with other people and all these type of things. And I'm not going into no great aura about that in the day that we live. I'm just giving you a picture of what was going on in this region. A whole lot of sins were going on in the region. A whole lot of things that displeased God was going on in the region. No, you can't point at one nationality of people and say this people and that people and that. No, it was people from all over that came into that region. Kings and dignitaries came into that region from other places, and in doing so, many of them sought the nightlife where they could get the women and have somebody to lay with to keep them warm. Over the years, many years ago, they didn't have a telephone for their wife to keep check on them, so they had it free. You better get it. I hope you get what I'm saying to you now. Well, you got to understand, these type of things were going on, and God was not pleased with it. No, you can't point the finger at one nationality of people. So this is the reason the Bible said kings of every nation and kindred and tongues of every nation, they were coming into this region. So you couldn't point the finger at one group of people and say, this this is them. Don't you know the people that came into it? They bought into the commerce in that area. Not only did they bring their goods to sale, but they were there in that city and they spent money. They spent money on women. They spent money on liquors, if you please, or things to drink, and they spent money on things to smoke, and whatever was there in the city at the time for them to get. They please excuse me. They spent great money there, and so this particular region become to be very, very wealthy, not only for the merchants that brought in their goods, but also the ladies of the night. That great hoy was known for this type of entertainment. They could do their dance, and they knew how to allure men and get the men's attention. Well, the Bible called it a great whore. We talked about it in the last verses that we read. Verse 2 again, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon, the greatest fallen, is fallen, and has become the habitations of demons, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Let's read verse 3. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. All nations. Now, so that's the reason I say you couldn't just point the finger here and there. But all nations have drunk of that wine of her fornication. And the kings of the earth have committed fornications with her. And the merchants of the earth are grown rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Well, that's exactly what I was saying. All of these type of things were going on, and people were getting rich even on the wrong things. Yes, they brought legitimate things in, but there was more things going on than legitimate business. Well, let's read in verse 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sin, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Well, God giving a command to his people, come out of her, come out of that, come out of that lifestyle, come away from it, get away from it, that way you won't receive the plagues right along with it. Well, shall we read in verse 5, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God hath remembered her iniquities. This is how severe it was. Their sins reached all the way to God. They reached up to heaven, and God saw the evil and the iniquities that was going on. Well, let's read. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her words, and to the cup which she has filled to filled to her double. We can go into that particular verse in more than one reason. He called his people out of it. And then he's making a statement. Now, if you owe them some money, give it to them. Give them double what they said. But then that verse goes for, reward her even as she is rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her works. In the cup which she has filled her double. And this is also the punishment and the plagues that God was going to put on it because of their sins. Let's read in verse 5. How much she had glorified herself and lived luxuriously, so much torment and sorrow give her. For she hath, she saith in her heart, I sit a queen. I am no widow and shall see no sorrow. In other words, I didn't get married. Now, well, you got to understand, the ladies on the street, they're not after somebody to live in with them all the time. You got to understand. I know sometimes love takes over and all that good stuff. I'm not going into that. But you got to understand what the writer here is saying. How much has she glorified herself and lived luxuriously? So much torment and sorrows give her, for she saith in her heart, I sent a queen, and I am no widow, and shall see no sorrow. In other words, I ain't got nobody telling me what to do. You got to get this understanding now. Let's read verse 8. Therefore shall her plagues come in one day, death and mourning and famine, and she shall be utterly burned with fire. For strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. Strong is the Lord God who judgeth her. Well, this letting us know that God is judging the area, not only judging the city, but judging the acts that went on in that city. Get the picture. No, we're not talking about a nationality of people, or one group of people. We're talking about an area and the great commerce that come through there, and all of the evil that came along with it. The prostitution, the drug trafficking, and even the slave traffic. All of these type of things went in through the city. So you got to understand that God was not pleased with it, and he will pour out his vengeance after a while. Many times God is long suffering with us, even in our mess and in our sins. But after a while, the judgment of the Lord will prevail. Well, let's read verse 9 and continue. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and live luxuriously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning. The kings of the earth, those that visited there, and all the wealthy men and women, whatever the case may be, that visited there, and all of the and took part in all of that, when they see it go up in smoke, they'll say, uh-oh, there go my fun now. Where am I going to go for the weekend? Well, don't take vacation. You got to understand. They will bewail. Let me read 9 again. And the kings of the earth who committed fornication and lived luxuriously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning. Let's read verse 10. Standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, the mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come. In 1 hour is thy judgment come. Don't you know when God speaks a word, it will happen? Any type of thing can happen. When God says the word and when God speaks the word, let's read verse 11. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, and no man buyeth their merchandise anymore. In other words, it's going to affect commerce not only in that one geological location, but all of those who do business through her, all of those who did do business, and many of the trafficking of the waterways and ports and things of that nature to where they can distribute it. Don't you know they will be affected as well when God rain the judgment down on the place? Well, I can go into times where this city has been bombed, before more than one time. I can go into that part of history. But what I want you to do is see the hand of God. When the hand of God moves, the hand of God moves. And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth her merchandise anymore. Let's read verse 12. The merchandise of gold and silver and precious stones and pearls and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all fine wood and all kinds of vessels of ivory and all kinds of vessels of most precious wood and of bronze and iron and marble. Can you see all of these things, all of the artifacts and all the things that come through this place, and how well the commercial structure was there? Let me read verse 13. And cinnamon and incense and ointments and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and cattle and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men. All of this traveled through that region. All of these things was for sale there. Even the slave traffic. Don't you know God turned? It got God's attention. And when you get God's attention, something's going to happen after a while. Well, my friends, I'm going to finish this particular chapter up on tomorrow. I challenge you to be here. We're going to talk about it more. Remember the call that I made in the first part of about, well, listen, today, if you are a minister, if you have a ministry, a credible ministry, and you teach a sound doctrine, teach the Bible, as we know it, teach the Bible, I want you to know, I want to send you people that come through this ministry or call us and receive salvation if they're in your area. I would like for you to get a hold of me. I'm going to give you contact and information momentarily, but get a hold of me. Give me your name and your number, your ministry name, and tell me a little bit about yourself. And I would love to send people who accept salvation through this ministry or just need spiritual guidance. I want to send them to you. So please send me your name and your number, your ministry, and tell us about yourself. I want to link with you and send the souls that we will not be able to deal with hands-on all over this country and in many other places in the world. If I know you, if I have your name and number, I can say, please go here, or I can call you and give you their information so that you can reach out to them and help them and tutor them in the ways of God. I'm not in this by myself. I love the Lord. You got to understand, not even trying to make a name for myself. I'm doing what God told me to do, and in doing so, souls are most important, and I need your help, somebody to lead these the souls of God to, so they can get nurtured in the way of the Lord. If you would like to contact me for any reason, you can write me at the Word with Chester Ministries, Post Office Box 200483, San Antonio, Texas, 78220. You can also contact me at my website, www.poemsbychester.com. Go to where it says about the author. There's a place for comments, and that will come directly to me. Please put your return information down. You can also reach us at our toll-free telephone number, 1-866-276-0211. We will respond. Well, my brothers and sisters, I need you, and I ask for you to pray for this ministry that God will lead us and guide us. Remember, I love you. I love you with the love of the Lord. God bless you.